priest trained by Nalingyao Perry Dennis Zulu to a surgery. And I've been around since the 1970s into the Sun Jemawaji. I was graduated in 1981, and I've traveled extensively to Ghana, and I've also done research at Latte for the entire year of 2008 at the shrine, which resulted in my dissertation research.
And you are?
My name is Akua Badu, and I also am an Akan priestess, Okomfos, Akua Badu. I come through the lineage of Nana Yao Pari Dinuzulu by way of Nana Akua Oparabia in Latte, Ghana. I am, in addition, a Nana Surgebi Okomfos. And for those who may not know, when we say an Okomfos to Nana Surgebi, Nana Surgebi is a patron deity from Latte, and he is our husband. When we say Okomfos to a deity, that means we have taken an oath where we consider we are married to that deity, to that spirit, and they are our guide, our husband, our everything.
Yes.
So we too are Nana Surgery priests.
Mm-hmm. Let me just ask you a couple of questions. And whoever wants to speak first can speak first.
Okay.
Who were you before you got into the Akan?
That is a trick
it's
question.
It's tricky and it's loaded. You ready?
We had our lives, you know, we had our lives before. Like, I guess I came through in 1976, and I have been searching since I left. I was born and raised in Indiana as a Christian, and I had been searching ever since I left Indiana in 1967. So I went through a lot of channels of the Nation of Islam, looking at Yoruba, transcendental meditation, you know, herbalism, that kind of thing. But when I got to the Akan, I felt like I was at home. So that's why I stayed. Once I got to that, to the Akan, I felt at home. I felt like it was family. I brought my family into it, my children. And I developed as the Basun Jemawaji was developing throughout the years.
And yourself?
My story is a little different. I came into the culture as a young lady, young girl actually. I was in third grade, and my mother, who befriended a woman who knew Nana Yao Pari Dinuzulu through African culture before the tradition, the Akan tradition, was brought to the Americas. So I'll mention Okomfos. She was Floretta Rush, an African dance teacher who was trained with Catherine Dunham.
Okay.
Catherine Dunham had her dance troupe. Nana Yao had the oldest dance company in America. And so they were all affiliates in Harlem. And so my mother became friends with Auntie Akoshua Insia. She became her seamstress for her dance troupe. And Akoshua and Akoshua became sisters. Nana Akoshua Insia introduced my family to the Akan culture. And therefore, I was a young girl in third grade. So, as I said, my story is different because I knew the culture, I was in the culture. Auntie was there when we came.
That's right, that's right.
And so, I grew normal life, regular life as a young woman coming up, middle school, high school, all of the above. But my role was like a zigzag, zigzag, zigzag. The culture was always there. The tradition was always there. I was Aku from third grade. So I'm happy that I had the opportunity to experience life, as some may say, oh, you went through all of that. But it was the Abosum that called me, the deities that called me back when I started realizing that life was helter-skelter and scattered all about due to my own actions, due to my own walk, my own choices. But when I went to them for help to say, look, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. It's okay, we'll help you, no problem. I didn't know it came with a course if you didn't take all of the medicine and follow the recipe. So I say that to say that the shrines are here. people, they have professed, when I say they have, the deities have professed that they had to come across the waters from Ghana to reclaim those of us ancestrally who were stolen away and brought and scattered throughout the Americas. I being one, Auntie being one, all who you see here today being of that lineage. And so I went to the shrines for help. They extended the recipes, the ingredients, everything that I needed to walk a straight path. In between, I went to Reiki, I went to Magnify Healing, meditation, spirituality, because it's all the same. Mm-hmm. However, your root is your root. Your source is your source. And when we receive our names, they're not just given as random.
That's true.
It has a path. And so I came back to my rightful path.
Yes.
I moved to Florida. Spirit said, oh, go to Florida. Go. Okay, I went there. I saw what was there for me. I gathered the little nutrients that were there for me. Spirit said, it's time to go back home in 2001. I'm like, go to Ghana? No, back to New York where you were born. So one of the first things that came about from going for divination upon returning back to New York in 2001, that I was called back to go in to do my priesthood training. So I began that training in 2002. And I graduated as Okomfos, Aku, Badu, Tanana surgery in 2007.
Let me ask both of you, and again, one at a time, I can answer. What, you can keep them, yeah, keep it up there. What's happening today? What are we doing today?
Well, what we're doing today is, this is called the Akom Kese. Akom has several meanings in the Akan tradition. Akom means possession. Akom means the ceremony. Akom means the lifestyle of the priests and priestesses. It's like an all-encompassing lifestyle to do with the traditional religion. It does mean worship. It means everything. So we come, and possession is what they call Akom. And then if you get possessed, you're called Okomfos. That means you're a person that possesses. And that means when you possess, you're carrying the lifestyle. You're carrying the spirits of the deities and the ancestors within you. Because the deities and the ancestors don't have a body. So they have a strong spirit that connects with a person, and they come through that person to bring blessings, to bring healing, to bring messages, to bring prophecies, to bring forecasts. So this is a big Akom and Akom Kese. So therefore, we're here to sort of like all of the shrine houses here on the East Coast, as many as possible, have been called to come here to celebrate our beginnings with Nana Parabia as well as Nana Demi Zulu through that particular lineage.
Tell me, Nana Para,
Nana Oparabia.
Nana Oparabia and Nana Demi Zulu. Tell me a little bit about who they are. And just.
Well, Nana Oparabia is the chief priestess of the Akonade Shrine in Kubati Larte, Ghana. She lived from 1900 to 1995. She was the one that was instrumental in putting the Akonade Shrine on the international map. She did it through the late President Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana. She did it through Nana Demi Zulu, Naniyao Perry Demi Zulu. She did it through him. She did it through all the connections that she made with African Americans. Not just Nana Yao Perry Demi Zulu, but other African Americans that came to her, and she helped them bring shrines back to the United States. So there's a lot of shrine houses here in the United States, especially on the East Coast, New York, Washington, Philadelphia, but there's also people in California, Michigan, all over the world, really, that she has given shrines to bring the Akonade worship and the Akonade spiritual tradition to globalize it, basically. And then Nana Denizulu.
I would like to just add one piece to Nana Oparabia. And then mm-hmm. I'll let mm-hmm. you, because mm-hmm. Auntie's the historian. She knows all the history verbatim. Nana Akua Oparabia, it is stated that, and you can see this in the Akans of America book that Nana Yao Parry documented, and also online and in Ghana when you go to Latte. It is stated that as a young girl, Nana Oparabia was taken. Her scenario, her testimony is something was calling her. She followed the calling. She wound up in the woods. The spirits called her and took her into what we would call training. And after being away from her family, what was it? Was there a time frame that was
probably
mentioned?
at least seven days.
Yeah, it was a period of time that she was away. And when she returned back to her village, she came back with Nana Surgery. Nana Surgery had possessed her and told her through his divination of possessing her what was to come for Latte. So that's how Nana Akua Oparabia became the chief and priestess of the Akonade Shrine through that scenario.
Lastly, so what are we going to see today? What are some of the things that are going to happen today?
Well, what we're going to see is we're going to see a celebration. We're going to see dancing, drumming, singing. We're going to have a celebration. There's going to be an array of drummers there playing the songs and the rhythms that the deities like, and we'll be calling down the deity. That's what an Akom will do. Drumming and singing, clapping, brings down the deity and the spirit of the deity, and we'll see people getting possessed. And that's our celebration. That's how we worship. And after that's done, we'll just have fellowship with each other. We'll have food. A lot of people that will be coming today haven't seen each other for a long time. So you're going to see that, sort of like a reunion kind of thing. That's what we're going to see today. And it's also a celebration of both of the founders, and that's what our ancestor altar will signify, the two of them, and just giving praise to what they have given us.
I would like to add to that, all that Auntie said is so, you will see it. But for one who, let's say if I bring a person to Akom, I break it down to them in the sense of the songs are symbolic of the deities. The deities carry their essence. The songs pay tribute to them. They speak about their attributes. The rhythms of the drum accompanies the song. The dances accompany the drum and the song. So you hear similarities of songs, but then when a song is for a different deity, you hear a change in the rhythm. One may be smooth, like Nana Isi Ketawa, she's smooth. Her rhythms are very, all I can say is smooth.
Boko,
we say in Ghana, Boko, like peaceful. And then you see Nana Dadi Kofi, his rhythms are fiery because of his energy, because of his essence. So the attributes of the deities, you hear it in the rhythms. You may not be able to identify, this is this one and this is this one. That takes work and experience and training, or as a guest, being around it.
Right.
And then you'll learn, the attributes of the deities when they come. You'll learn how to identify them by their characteristics.
Yeah.
You'll learn that, this song is for this deity, even if the deity's not here. And so, as Auntie stated, when the spirit's here, and they've said to us, we came because you've called us. The drum sound is sweet. You dance so wonderfully. We wanted to come and partake. So it's a celebration, and there's no age. You see little babies on their mother's lap moving because it's a spirit in it. It's a liveliness in it, and we live this life, and I love it. Mm-hmm. You love it too.
I love it. Hello. Yes, indeed.
Yes.
So are we going to see the two of you partake in some of this?
Of course.
That's what Okomfos do. We're not bystanders.
Okay, I hear you.
We participate. Yes. You can participate if you want.
Put the camera down. I just might. The spirit might move me.
That's right. Get the sensation.
Yeah. Yes. And you too.
We got a job to do, though.
Okay.
Thank you, though.
All right. Thank you.